Hi, this is former pro football sensation and future Toronto mayor, Mike Pinball Clemens. You're listening to the Dean Blundell Show on 102.1 The Edge. Now, I'm going to warn you, some of the material on DBS may not be for everyone, like their story about the three lawyers that walk into a whole... not paying 20 bucks donkey for their faces. Never go to the whole... again. The end. Wow. Please listen with discretion. Thank you.
The Dean Blundell Show. Going dick head free.
In T-minus 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, D, 9, 6, D, 9, 6, D, 9.
The Dean Blundell Show.
Dean Blundell and Todd. Those are the only guys that when I listen to them, I'm just howling on the way to work or school.
I've never laughed so hard in my life.
The Dean Blundell Show. 102.1. The Edge.
This is your Edge Files with Dean Blundell on the Edge.
Martha Stewart says she could roll a joint that would put others to shame. Apparently, at New York's 92nd Street YMCA recently, supporter of a new book, Living the Good Long Life, A Practical Guide to Caring. The homemaker, who's 71, told Andy Cohen of Bravo an amusing anecdote, saying, shoot, I was driving here tonight and there was a stupid ice cream truck in front of me, something good ice cream or something, she said, and we pulled right up next to it and a girl and a guy were smoking joints. I said, boy, those are sloppy joints. Your weed even needs to be perfect, doesn't it? I think I'd still tap that. She just gonna
mess her hair a bit.
Yeah.
Just want to mess her hair.
Yeah, and get her like a leather coat or something. To which she added, of course I know how to roll a joint. Saying she used to do it all the time in the 60s and the 70s.
Man, she's cool.
Yeah, she is. I mean, she can set one hell of a Thanksgiving Day table, and she can roll a huge dube in a pinch, too. Imagine, she's a grandma. Imagine having your grandma roll a joint for you.
Yeah, that'd be pretty neat. Joint, too.
Graham, come here, babe. Come here. Roll this.
Probably ground you for not rolling it perfect.
Oh, yeah. What are you doing? Sad story, but the circumstances are very interesting. A woman tragically killed her husband and herself while backing up her car in an underground parking garage in a province in China. The 41-year-old driver, surnamed Lynn, that was her last name, that's the only details you're giving, issued a driver's license in May and was practicing backing up her Lexus into a parking spot as her husband directed her from behind.
Oh, no.
And she backed up too far, pinned him against the wall, according to the report. That's when she stuck her head out the window upon hearing her husband scream and accelerate in an attempt to move forward. However, she forgot to change gears from reverse to drive, which not only killed him instantly, caused her head to get stuck between the car and the door of the parking spot and the actual pillar it was parking next to.
Oh. That's tough.
Rescue teams arrived shortly after, but she died from her injuries as well. A source close to the couple said that the woman had successfully parked in that space once before that day, but her husband asked her to do it again because she needed the practice.
Hmm. Oh, he wasn't wrong.
Ooh. Ooh, man. Ooh.
Wow. Probably a good lesson there.
Yeah.
You never stand behind or in front of a car with someone who needs that much practice. When there's a wall.
Yeah, you probably shouldn't. Yeah. You're just a director from a walkie-talkie or something.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's what I'd have been doing. And this kind of stuff makes my heart happy. On the weekend, the Miami Heat improbable comeback to win the NBA championship. Not even the story that anybody cares about.
No.
Drake, who's friends with LeBron, who was seen being his bitch later in the evening apparently as well.
Oh, was he?
Yeah, okay. Yeah, he's carrying his drinks and stuff. I'm not even kidding you.
Ah.
Tried to get into the Miami Heat locker room. This made its way around Twitter like crazy. It was actually trending at one point. And he was told he couldn't come in, to which he responded, I am media, which he's not. But I want you to listen to it and the people dying laughing at him as he's trying to get into the locker room.
This is so awesome.
Why on earth a grown man would want to go into a change room with other grown men is beyond me. But anyway, have a listen.
This is media. Pure media.
Drink and it turned out.
He said, not even for me. And they go, no, just media. And then he replies, I am media.
Let him in, friends.
No, this is media. Pure media.
Drink and it turned out.
Did you hear that? Did you hear, no access for anybody but us, he said. Did you hear the start of that? What a guy. He thinks he's so important.
So
it's
cool.
Crazy.
He's the best.
Let him in, friends.
No access. No, this is media. Hear me.
Drink and it turned out.
The dude that's with Drake too is dying laughing. He's like, yeah, this is really happening. This guy is such a wiener.
I am media.
Okay, bud. Those are your Edge Files, whatever the hell day it is in June, the year 2013.
The Edge Files
on 102.1.
The Edge.
This is.
Floods in Alberta, folks. You can make a donation to the Red Cross. Good idea to do it, too, because they need some money and a lot of people displaced. And that is one crazy flood. I was watching the video of the river go flying down the Canmore. It was like a third world country. It took away people's homes. Their backyards have disappeared. Rivers that were this wide are like twice as wide now. And then I started thinking, who on earth builds their house on the river? In the mountains. I mean, it sounds like a nice deal, but you would know, right? Wouldn't you know? Maybe
at some point.
Yeah.
Yeah, I guess. But I mean, they've never seen anything like this.
No, and you can't predict it, right? No. It's just, but if you get a chance, go and donate to the Red Cross, the Alberta Relief. You can just go on Twitter and look for some stuff. I've retweeted a few things. So at It's Dean Blundell, if you want to see some pretty crazy video and how you can help donate to the Alberta Red Cross Society. For the flood victims, crazy stuff.
There's some really nice tweets going around. One of them was a retweet of some Kijiji ads with people in Calgary who had homes that weren't affected.
Yeah.
Inviting people to stay. We have a spare bedroom. We have a basement. Like, you know, you always hear those great stories that come out of it. So.
And you'd hope, too, when that happens, you would hope that that only hot chicks would come and stay with you.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Or imagine if you just got evacuated from your home.
In like a group of like 5 24-year-old girls that all work in a law office.
Yeah.
That do meth on the weekends.
Party invite, girls on the weekends.
Yeah. Professional during the week.
Yeah. They invite you over.
We have an extra bed for some young stud.
Thank God for the flooding.
It's nuts, though. It's a lot. Like, and if you know the city, I used to live in Calgary, and if you know the city, what's flooded, like, for the Saddle Dome to be flooded, that's a long way away from the river.
So,
like, it's downtown proper, right? And the Bow River runs right through Calgary, but, like, past the zoo, so who knows? But Stampede Fairgrounds and where the Calgary Saddle Dome are, long way from the river. So, you know, it's bad.
So, I mean, and I've been to Calgary, but briefly, it's generally land in Calgary, and like, you know, you drive a little bit outside of it. Could you compare it to something to the ACC? Like, you know, would it be Yonge Street? Would it be the Don Valley River?
Yonge Street, ACC, the sky don't be like everything being underwater.
Unbelievable.
Yeah. And it's not a small city. Like, there's a million people there.
Yeah, the Flames are saying, like, all their locker rooms are destroyed.
The scoreboard's destroyed.
Their equipment, everything.
A total loss, they said. And they saw pictures of it, too. If you looked in the Saddle Dome, it was up past the boards, the half boards. All that water.
That's insane.
And like I said, I mean, that's something because Calgary's way above sea level. So that was a lot of rain.
Bored, lonely, hard up. Use your free hand and follow the boys on Twitter.
At Dean Blundell Show.
The Dean Blundell Show. 102.1.
The Edge.
Time for them emails and phone calls. This is from Jared on Twitter. He said, man, this guy just can't stop being an asshat. So last week, Justin Bieber ran someone over with his white Ferrari. This week, police were in his community in Calabasas, California. It's one of those gated communities, to speak to residents who complained about the singer's associates allegedly speeding around the area in his white Ferrari. Associates, his little buddies,
his paid for friends.
Yeah, his bought friends. An emergency meeting of the community's homeowner association has now been set for Monday to address the neighbors' concerns about Bieber's behavior. One identified local said, quote, "It's been escalating for 6 months. He's begun to flip over to a really dark side. It's aggressive, reckless behavior. They've sent him warnings. He's out of control. Everyone has a Bieber white Ferrari story. God forbid someone gets hurt by that damned car," some woman said. "He just feels like he's above the law." The 19-year-old superstar, previously investigated by authorities for racing his Ferrari around the Oaks. That's his community, the Oaks. Sounds nice, doesn't it?
Yeah.
Doesn't sound like some 19-year-old dickhead should be living at the Oaks.
No, not just some punk. We're having basically a fraternity house of rich kids.
Yeah. He was reportedly cleared after emerged his, it wasn't him driving around. It was his rapper pal, Tyler, the creator, behind the wheel.
Tyler, the creator.
Yeah, that guy. Residents are also said to be angry about late-night parties as well as guests parking on the road overnight. TMZ also posted a picture of his housemates, Lil Za and Lil Twist, racing through the singer's Calabasas neighborhood. Lil Za and Lil Twist. Yeah. That's you know why he's called Lil Twist? That's what Justin asks him to do right at the end of their lovemaking sessions.
It's a move.
Yeah, give me the Lil Twist.
Perfected. Thing can't be that big either because he's not called Big Twist.
No, you're not called Massive Twist. So Instagram has video now, and Bieber posted his first video on it, High as a Kite. Have a listen. This is I can't fault the guy for trying to have a good time, but come on. Is he not aware that the rest of the world sees this stuff?
It just seems so out of it or so high or something.
Wasted.
So crazy news.
I like guys.
So crazy news. No, I'm keep going. Crazy news, guys. There's video on Instagram. I don't know.
That's it.
Wow.
Yeah.
I'm gonna keep going. So embarrassing, these people. They come from around here.
I know.
Him, Drake. It's so annoying.
Yeah, the two biggest stories after the weekend, unfortunately, and people get mad, but are Drake getting turned down from trying to go into the Miami Heat locker room? I think he was mistaken. He thought it was a meat locker room where he could just meet guys. But, and then the Bieber thing again. And yeah, they are from here. Are they friends? Do they know each other? They must.
They must. I don't know. Those two better not start doing everything together. Or if they do, get in that white Ferrari and just drive real fast.
So no one can see you doing it. It's very odd. Very odd behavior. Anyway. Part of the problem that I have with the Biebs, too, is that he doesn't seem to care about anybody else but himself. Do you know what I mean? Like, every story you hear is about him only caring about himself. And then you know what he does? He goes to, like hospitals to visit kids that are sick just to get pictures with them. So he's like, oh, yeah, I got to go do that now. So people don't think I'm a giant, massive loser.
Has he even done that, really?
Yeah,
I guess recently, yeah.
Yeah.
It's just this pompous, self-entitled attitude. If you have that much influence, and I don't care what age you are, got a lot of money. I'm pretty jealous.
Yeah, he did. Did you see yesterday they said he made like $78 million this last year?
Yeah, it's a pretty good year for the kid.
Yeah, 19. He could just buy his own racetrack and drive around.
Yeah?
Yeah, if I was him.
Yeah, I might as well do that.
I'm going to drive like a dick. Buy your own racetrack. You can probably buy one for about $10 million. Nice one, too.
Little Twist, eh? That's the guy's name, huh?
That's his move right at the end. Good little twist. Hey, guys, speaking of pop star dickheads, did you hear about Aaron Carter getting beat up by New Kids on the Block fans? Pop singer Aaron Carter, yeah, he did. Sporting a black eye when he took to the stage for a gig in Boston, Massachusetts after a street fight with a gang of New Kids on the Block fans.
That's a tough gang. That's a real tough gang.
Hang in tough. How do you even start a fight about that? No, these guys... No, wait. You're the... No, you came after... NSYNC sucks. We're New Kids on the Block fans. Your brother was in NSYNC, so we got to fight. I Want Candy singer, whose big brother was in Backstreet, Nick Carter, claims he was beaten up by four guys.
Oh, yeah, his brother. That's right.
Yeah, he's in the Backstreet.
Kind of glad
back
I didn't know
that. Backstreet's back. All right. Says he was beaten up by four guys after they took issue with the singer appearing at the New Kids' hometown. Yo, this is our turf. This is New Kids on the Block territory. We don't want any of that Backstreet boy brother crap.
How pathetic do you have to be to be
massive
a gang?
Loser? Well, it gets even better, though. Yeah. Aaron Carter posted photos of his battered face and bruised knuckles on Instagram Sunday, adding, I think my knuckles might be broken, but that's what they get. People think I'm a pretty little white boy, but no way. I think I won. I'm still standing. I'm a 6-degree black belt in Muay Thai. They lost. So this gang of New Kids on the Block, not that that's the coolest thing I've ever said. This gang of New Kids on the Block fans lost in a fight to Aaron Carter.
They're going to feel great about themselves today.
Yeah. It's bad enough we like the band. We had to lose a fight to Aaron Carter and there was seven of us.
I mean, I could maybe understand this back in like, you know, mid-90s. Or something, whenever they...
Dude, not even.
When were they popular?
I don't know.
2000 or something?
Yeah. But a New Kids on the Block gang?
You need a life, man. They haven't even been relevant.
No. Hey, there's Aaron Carter. Let's get him.
New Kids are from right here, not you guys.
Yeah. You keep your Florida trash down in Florida.
The Dean Blundell Show, 102.1.
The Edge!
We're just having a laugh because Nicole, our call screener, so she leaves the room with her purse and then comes back in with the purse. And I know exactly what that. Anytime a woman goes somewhere with her purse and says, I have to use the washroom, you know what's going on.
Mm-hmm.
We know what's happening. You don't have to be embarrassed. It's part of life.
About once a month for a few days.
Yeah.
Go to the washroom with your purse.
But what I'm saying is if you want to be more discreet, don't go with the purse. Just go with the thing you need from the purse.
In a big pocket. You have a pocket?
You have a pocket in those things? You got a sleeve? Yeah, you hide it up the sleeve like Copperfield. What?
She's so embarrassed.
Why?
Look at her. She's like...
But I'm saying, as you get older, it's a dead giveaway.
Put in your shirt. Hide it in your shirt.
Come here. Sit down. Come here.
So embarrassed.
Come on. Come on. Get over it. You're a young lady. You're in your 20s.
Nice Blue Jays shirt, by the way. Way to represent when they're doing well. Yeah. You were wearing that a couple weeks ago.
They're winning 11 in a row.
No, but what I'm saying is that when you get older, you're going to need to know this for future reference. Just if I know it's a special time right now. I know it's a gentle time
like
for you.
I'm getting the birds and the bees
are.
Talk.
It's a gentle time for you. As a man who notices it pretty much everything, and I'm a bit of a freak that way, what you need to do is if you're going to go to the bathroom to freshen up, if you know what I'm saying, don't go with your whole purse because it's a dead giveaway. You'll have guys running for the exits if you go to the bathroom with your whole purse.
Just or the wrong ones running in.
Yeah.
All right.
Did you not know that?
No, I knew that, but it was kind of a last minute. You know what? I just...
It's not a last minute thing. All I'm saying is, if you're going to go, just go with your product. You don't have to go with the whole purse.
It's sometimes hard to sneak that out, because sometimes that's really obvious, too, when you're, like, digging through your purse and you're, like, stuffing it.
That's a good point.
So it's like...
Well, you got
a
pre-plan. No. But who knows? Maybe you're looking for Tic Tacs. Who knows? Maybe you're looking for gum, a pen.
On my shirt?
A pen. No, no, but you just slide it in your hand. So what you do is this. Okay, pull your... I'm gonna give you hep feminine hygiene product advice here. So pull your your sleeve down. Your whole exactly right.
Okay.
And so you push right in there like that.
Oh yeah, no one would know.
No one would have a clue.
Especially it's like air conditioning. Looks cold in here, so you just pull your sleeves over your hands.
Ooh, yeah. It's freezing.
Yeah.
And really, you're gonna go swap one out, which is great.
Oh my god.
Although you gave me an idea, they should make them as small as Tic Tacs.
Yeah.
And then they could
expand.
Yeah, that would be because then you could have them in
have a whole pack of Tic Tacs.
Yeah, they kind of look like.
Where are you going? Going to the bathroom to have a Tic Tac.
Yeah.
I don't know that you really know how it works, though.
Oh, I know how it works.
Trust me. Yeah. Every guy's done the starting the lawnmower or whatever.
Listen, all I'm saying is maybe next time don't take the whole purse. It's good advice from a man who's been on this planet for over 35 years. To a woman who's been on this planet for under 35 years, it's good advice.
Well, yeah. You know what? I just... I don't even know what
to
say.
Oh, I'm starting to get it now. That's why she turned the first three dudes gay.
Whoa! What? Wow!
Well, it's true, isn't it?
Not in a row.
Not in a row, but the first three serious relationships you had, they all turned out to be gay.
The first three serious ones.
Well, first
one
three
was
out
very
there.
Serious.
Regular ones.
Okay, yes. Regular relationships, yes.
Yeah.
Okay.
It's because you're not up to speed on some of the etiquette. Maybe you turned them right off.
Oh, man.
Oh, my God. You make me sound like a monster.
No, I'm not. I'm just saying. If you're
awesome.
Gonna,
I'm
if
never
going
to be
go,
able to date anyone in Toronto ever again.
Nicole, if you're going to go to the bathroom to do that thing... Don't take the whole purse.
Okay.
Just to do what you like. I mean, you're a great girl. I love having you here. You're a lot of fun. You do a great job. You're energetic. You're ambitious. Just if it's that time, don't take your whole purse to the can.
I can't even.
How's that for advice, huh?
It's pretty good advice.
Yep.
Not even 8 o'clock.
It's what I do.
You're so embarrassed.
It's what I do.
I don't know why.
You're a little, we know why. Yeah. You're a little emotional.
Yeah,
it's okay.
And you're over 19, so it's a woman thing. We know why.
Right.
What happens with the ovum is this.
Oh, my God. I just want to
That's
go back
why.
To my corner.
Okay, go. But it's the reason why I brought it up is it's good advice for every young lady to know.
I think so, too.
Don't take the whole purse.
It's like a dude going to the washroom with a newspaper tucked under his arm. Like,
yeah.
Yeah.
You know
we might as well just announce we got to go take
like going to the restaurant
piece.
Going, yeah. Anybody have a paper here? Yeah. I got a growler just dying to come out. I'm going to be down there a bit.
Well, okay. Usually I don't.
Sports Illustrated,
come
anyone?
On.
Huh?
Got to do
you
a couple things
you guys announce when you
there.
Have to poop?
No, we don't. I don't. Todd goes.
Yeah.
Todd announces. I have to. I just go. Yeah, I'm going to the bathroom. I'll be back.
Yeah.
No, you kind of.
No.
You talk about how awesome yours was, though.
Yeah, after for sure I do. Yeah.
I can toss it.
It's totally different. No, it's different, though. This is a different thing. I'm saying, as a female, you want to be a little mysterious. That's the deal. You want it all right out there. Hey, I'm going to the bathroom with this massive leather purse. What do you think's going on with me?
That is
maybe I was fixing my makeup. I have a makeup bag in there.
You're not wearing any.
I am too. I have mascara and eyeshadow. Ooh. I wear makeup.
Very little.
Very little, but
so I know you
still
weren't fixing your
fix
makeup.
It.
You look the same when you came back as you did when you left.
Could be how mysterious I am.
No. No, there's no mystery at all. I know exactly what's going on with your physiology.
God, that's weird.
It's just science. I'm just a little piece of, a little nugget of advice. Call it a pro tip.
Nugget too, huh?
Yeah. A nugget.
The Dean Blundell Show.
On 102.1.
Yeah. Todd got a chance to go and catch up with the cast set of the cast of Cats.
Yeah, I'm doing a bunch of different things, getting out, trying to meet new people. This week, I'm actually going to go talk to people from the Toronto Rush.
Oh, you're kidding.
Yeah.
That's the Frisbee League.
Yeah, how awesome is that going to be? Okay.
Well, here's Todd with a member of the set of Cats.
The Dean Blundell Show proudly presents...
Toy out on the street, getting to know...
Here again at the Panasonic Theater backstage for the production of Cats. I'm sitting with another very beautiful lady, Marisa...
Falcone.
Marisa Falcone.
That's right.
Yeah, are you Italian?
Yeah, a little bit.
Yeah. What's the other little bit?
No, it's fully Italian.
It's fully Italian, right? And are you from Toronto? Are you from Maple?
I'm from Mississauga, born and raised.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. So that's cool. Have you done this stuff before? Or is this like your first crack at it?
This is not my first crack at it. This is my second show right smack dab in the city.
Did you win like a Battle of the Bands before or something, or like a talent show?
No, that would be a good story. Yeah. But no. Over Christmas, I did Ross Petty's panto at the Elgin Theater, Snow White.
Now you're doing Cats, though.
Now I'm doing Cats. Yeah. Like 6 months later, I'm back.
Oh, I thought you were going to swear. Like, I thought you were going to say, like, holy
shit. I'm really excited.
And you're one of the lead roles. Like, you play a lead cat.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, the cool thing about this show is that it is an ensemble-driven show.
What does that mean? Like a bunch of you?
So, exactly. We each have our own cat name. We each have our own cat.
You like the Smurfs.
Moments. Yeah, I guess
you're
so.
Kind of like the Smurfs.
I guess so. So
it's like Grumpy Smurf. There's whatever, Daddy, Father Smurf, and then there was there was the one chick Smurf. What was her name again?
I don't know.
She was a bit of a. I was worried about her. One girl, all those dudes. Crazy, right?
She held it down.
Yeah. So, but now you have like there's a lot of guy cats. There's a lot of girl cats.
Yeah.
Do they show someone snaking eggs? It's tight. Like tight on a guy. Do guys ever? I should have asked Robert that. Do guys complain about that?
I'm sure they have some beef about having to wear spandex.
Well said. Night. Have some beef about it. So, and with you, when you wear spandex, like
all the bits are in place.
Like you have to clean up and make sure, because you got to look all aerodynamic.
Yes.
It must be sweaty in that thing.
Oh, it's completely sweaty. Yeah. I'm in it. Sorry, my inner cat just came out.
Did you do that in the thing?
That's my reflex.
That's really sexy. My goodness.
Well, Demeter is a really cool.
That's your cat, Demeter.
Yeah, that's
Demeter?
Demeter.
Demeter. It's like a Spanish guy saw like, where are you gonna put the money? In Demeter. Like
I've never heard that, but that was awesome. Yeah.
Yeah, kind of. Do you clean yourself as a cat? You know, cats clean themselves.
I mean we appear to clean ourselves.
Do you have a rough tongue?
Like our paw and then like wipe away our ear and our fur and stuff like that.
Do you have a rough tongue? Do you like, no?
Smooth.
Yeah, can I see? No, with my, no? I can't.
No, that's mine.
Yeah, I thought it's your tongue, yeah.
Which I think is weird, but I'll go right back at you.
And which is just as strange, but you're rolling with the punches.
Yeah, right.
Yeah. Yeah. Are you impressed knowing what we do that I haven't made like a pussy joke?
Until now.
Yeah. No, right? Because I didn't go there. That was the obvious. Like, were you guys bad pussies on stage? Or I didn't do any of that stuff.
Thank you for not doing that.
I'm very proud of this production being here. It's a legendary production.
It is.
I know Barbara Streisand sung that song, Memory.
Memory.
Do you sing it in here?
No, that's the one that Grisabella sings.
Oh, I heard that. I forgot her. Exactly. So what do you sing? Can you give me a taste?
I sing McCavity.
Can you give me like a 8-second sample?
Sure. McCavity's a mystery cat. He's called the Hidden Paw. For he's a master criminal who can defy the law. He's the bafflement of Scotland Yard, the flying squad's despair. For when they reach the scene of crime, McCavity's not there.
Oh, I didn't record that.
Oh, shoot.
Yeah, no, I did. So real quick, why should a dude who's 28 years old, who's just more consumed with going to a patio and having a couple of beers, come down and see Cats on a Friday night and bring his girlfriend?
A, the cats are sexy. We're all in unitards and spandex.
Which is like you're naked. It's like you can see. We could probably tell what size bra you wore.
If you looked hard, I guess you could. Yeah.
I guess you're an A.
Sure.
No, yeah.
Oh my god. And I think it appeals to a lot of people.
Everyone, stick with the sexy cat, so.
Okay, fine. It's sexy. We're sexy. And support live theater.
Have you ever had a bad meal before our show and you had to go on? Is that? Well, thank you very much, Marisa. I was going to say Marisa. Okay, thank you so much. It's been a pleasure. And we really look forward to seeing you on stage. You're quite a talent.
Thank you, man. Okay,
support local arts, people. Go see Cats running until July 28th at the Panasonic Theater.
Tired on the street, getting to know your cat.
102.1 The Edge.
That cat had small boobs, I guess.
Yeah, she was. But a great ass, that cat. Yeah.
This is the Dean Blundell Show.
102.1.
Time for Wha Happened. Best confession wins. We got Edgefest tickets. We've got City and Color tickets and more as well.
Yeah, Wonderland 4-pack and Wake Stock just announced August 9th to 11th, 2013. Festival passes.
All right. Tristina.
Hi.
What a name that is, Tristina.
There's no T in the middle. Just Tristina, actually.
Tristina?
Yep.
Tristina. Two S's, no T.
Just one S.
Tristina. Yeah, where's that from?
My parents made it up.
Oh.
My two grandmothers' names kind of mashed together.
Wow. Whatever happened to, like, Jane or Sarah or, you know?
That's boring.
Yeah, I guess so. Anyway, thanks for calling.
No problem. Thanks for having me.
No problem. You're from Hamilton?
Yes, I am.
Wha Happened? Hey, Wha Happened?
That explains it.
Yep. So I'm a child and youth worker. I work in a group home, and I work in a home with lots of aggression. So we do lots of containments and stuff. And
like you put them in boxes?
No, that would be too easy.
Oh, restraint.
Yeah, restraint.
Oh, I'm sorry. A containment sounded like you put them in cages or something.
No physical containment.
Did it not? Put them in containment. He's five. Anyway, I'm glad to hear you don't put people in cages.
Yeah, it's nice.
No, not at all.
No.
No, there's, you know, human rights and all that stuff.
Something like
that,
yeah. Plus, it's mean. Well, if it wasn't against the law, you know.
I mean, if we didn't get caught,
we'd
maybe.
Contain everybody. Sorry, go ahead.
That's okay. So we were in, like, a lot of containments one night. And so naturally, I just thought, like, that it was getting really hot in the room and that I was getting really sweaty and all that. And then once we had kind of, you know, debriefed and gone out of restraints and all this, I looked at the person that we were restraining, and then I looked at myself, and I realized that he had peed all over me.
Oh.
Yeah.
How old was said person?
21 years old.
Okay.
Oh, no.
No.
Yeah.
Did he mean to? Was it like he knew what he was doing?
Yeah.
Oh, that was his move.
That's his defense mechanism. You know how, like, chameleons will change color? Those guys whiz on people.
Protect themselves. Yeah, it's natural. Yeah.
Sure. Yeah, that's my move. Jenny.
Hello.
How are you?
Good, thanks. How are you?
Good. Where are you calling from?
Mississauga.
Wha Happened?
Hey, Wha Happened?
What the f*** happened?
So when I was about 16, 17 in high school, mm-hmm. I went on a date. It was my first real official date. And I wore these really tight beige pants to the movies with this guy. Uh-oh. And during the movie, I got my period. And I had no idea, didn't know what happened. I left the theater, walking about halfway out, and I realized that everybody was staring at me.
Oh, God.
Yeah. So after I thought, okay, this must be something wrong. So I went to the bathroom. And when I got there, I looked down and I saw blood everywhere, all over the front, all over the back. And it was the most embarrassing thing. I had to call my mom to come to the theater, to come into the washroom with a pair of pants and a sweater so that I could hide myself and run out of the theater.
Wow.
It was horrible.
It's a curse.
That's been a scary
women
movie.
Women are cursed. Yeah, it does. Magic. Was it a scary movie? What kind of movie was it?
No, it was a chick flick, and it was. Oh, my God, it was so
hard. Yeah. That'd be awesome. It was a scary movie.
Yeah. Oh, they got her, too.
Yeah. Ari.
Yeah, how you doing, dude?
Good, man. Good. Where are you calling from?
I'm just in Markham now.
All right.
Wha Happened?
So I was driving with my wife, and we were cruising there, stopped at a light, and I farted, basically, and it was so bad. She started going, oh, my God, and put down the window, and the guy next to us in the car, we were stopped, and she was saying, oh, it smells so bad. He had his window down. The wind came through. He got a full whiff of it. And he basically, you know, got fart bombed, so I killed both of them with one.
In the car next to you?
Yeah, kind of the wind when she opened.
You sick? Window. Are you all right?
Well, she's lately been going, you know, you're reaching 40, start eating that, like, psyllium husk stuff. And,
yeah.
Oh, man,
it's a shock to your system if you don't normally eat lots of fiber. Wow.
Like a typical guy, though, eh? Blamed it on her.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
That's what I'd do, too. Yeah. I'd just take the thumb and go, it was her. Shaq.
Hello.
How are you?
Sad.
Why?
Oh. Wha Happened?
Well, you know what it's like when you wake up in the morning, you're ready to go to school, but you have the sudden urge of diarrhea ready to come out all the time, constantly. It's making you late, and it's hard. And...
Yeah. No, I don't, thank God. You need to go to the doctor.
Yeah.
John.
Hey, morning, guys. How are you?
What's up, dude? Good.
So this was a few years ago.
Wha Happened? Hey, Wha Happened?
Enjoying myself at the Molson Indies, having a drink. Actually, struck up a conversation with a really cute girl. when all of a sudden, from out of nowhere, this bombardier, red baron of a seagull, swooped in, dropped a deuce on me, hit me right between the eyes, and knocked the sunglasses off my face.
That's a big poop.
Yeah, man.
That must have been some kind of seagull. But you didn't come out of a movie theater looking like you just got stabbed, so we'll give it to Jenny. Congratulations.
You should have started screaming. Yeah.
I'm so excited because honestly, it was such a traumatic moment in my life. So I'm glad it paid off and I got these glass screen tickets.
Yeah. And that's a good way to look at it. You're a real glasses half full kind of chick, aren't you? Pardon the pun.
Yeah.
This is the Dean Blundell Show.
The Dean Blundell Show.
102.1 The Edge.
Joining us on the telephone. Mm.
Oh, do you have his music?
Is this, are you all right with this? You okay?
He still bugs me.
Yeah, for no reason.
I haven't seen him for a year and a half. No, I've got pretty good reasons. Yeah.
No, I mean like to no reason right now, other than the fact that it's just the memories of what he put us through for so long.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, play it.
Such a big keener, he's got a little wiener.
M-E-A-T-U-S.
Meatus.
Did you miss that, Matt?
I did not.
Yes, you did.
Good morning.
Good morning. How are you?
I'm doing well.
Well, you're in medicine. Meatus is our old producer, folks. Just to bring you up to speed, if you're a new listener, he used to do what Sean does, but a far worse job.
Yeah, it took a lot of more abuse.
Yeah, yeah. Way more. And then a couple years ago, now it's about 2 years, is that right?
About 2 years now.
Okay, 2 years, you moved out to take a job in Medicine Hat, Alberta, where you're going to start doing some swing and some overnights and some evenings and some day. And then they're going to, and how's that going?
It's going really well. I'm actually doing some stuff on TV now too, so it's kind of.
Oh, what kind of TV stuff in Medicine Hat?
Stuff with the sports team. The sports. We have a TV station in the basement of our radio station. It's just a local station, and I just kind of help out with some of the Tiger stuff. We have the Medicine Hat Tigers, the WHL team, and I help out with that.
Yeah.
Do some interviews and that kind of thing.
Oh, good for you. That's not why we called. We didn't call to get a career update. You know why we called, right?
Yeah, I do.
Okay, so there's flooding in Calgary, and apparently Medicine Hat, because it's down the river, is the next one to take it right up the chute. So what's going on there today?
Today, the river peaked overnight. They were going to close. We have three bridges that divide that help join the city together.
Medicine Hat's cut in half.
Yeah, it's cut right in half. So they closed two of the bridges yesterday around 10:30 in the morning, and then they were going to say that they were closing 7 o'clock, the last bridge, which is the highway bridge. It didn't end up happening, but there was some chaos on the highway. People slowing down to see the water rising, trying to get to the other side of town and getting into accidents and just causing a huge backup. But it didn't end up happening. They ended up canceling that order, and everything ended up okay in the end.
Is it okay, though, because like a lot of the city's underwater, right?
Yeah, a good chunk of the area called Riverside, and there's another area called the Flats.
Listen, it's not okay.
Chunk,
like half of Medicine Hat's underwater, and you're like, everything's fine.
No, you're right. It's not okay, but it hasn't peaked as high as it said it would.
Yeah,
they said it would. So we don't know what the damage is at.
Where do you live?
I live in an area called South Ridge, which is away from the water.
Okay.
We're safe.
Okay, so how far, have you seen it? Have you seen how high the water is?
Yeah. In the arena, it's where the Tigers play, it's about at the boards now.
No way.
Yeah, it's about as high as the boards.
So that's like 2.5-3 feet, or maybe more.
It's getting up there, but now they're saying the water's receding, which is good news.
Hey, it's getting up there. There's Meatus' take on the flood in Medicine Hat.
How far is Calgary
getting
from
up there? Like a couple hours.
Okay. Yeah. Have you been down to, have you gone to see what's going on in Calgary, Meatus?
No. No, it's about three hours to get there, and it's just haven't been going to the Stampede in a couple weeks, so we'll see if that's even still on.
Yeah, no kidding. Because the whole thing's flooded, dude. Like, the Stampede grounds flooded. The Calgary Saddle Dome's completely flooded. Apparently, they lost all their equipment. Is a write-off. Their scoreboard's a write-off. Everything on the lower main level's a write-off.
Yeah, no, it'll definitely be interesting to see how, if they, with the Stampede, if it continues or they postpone it because of cleanup.
Hey, how many people got evacuated from Medicine Hat?
They evacuated 10,000 people, but the last time I heard, since yesterday, after 10 people refusing to leave their houses.
Yeah, and they apparently found, in Calgary, they found some old guy that wouldn't leave, and that didn't go well.
No.
Can't you get arrested, too? I heard the guy from Medicine Hat say that you can get arrested if you don't leave.
Yeah, they were threatening to use force, and actually they're arresting anybody going into the evacuated area now.
Hmm. Do you know anybody in the evacuated area? Like, have you heard any stories about people's homes and how high the water is and some of the damage?
We haven't really heard any stories. People are, complying with it, so they haven't really seen their homes yet, for the most part.
Oh, okay.
Other than those 10 people that just won't leave.
So you working on a radio station over there, what kind of messages are you giving out to people? Are you still trying to be, I don't know, do you try and be funny on your radio show now? How does that work for you?
Yeah, that's hilarious. They try.
We literally just keep people updated with stuff on the city website, the Facebook page, and the Emergency Alberta Service and all that stuff, and just kind of keep people informed. We don't have a news station here, and our TV station can't go live with anything, so we were kind of held responsible with that.
So can you give us an example, if we were to be like, citizens of Medicine Hat, and there was just a song ending, how would you now, after a few years of leaving here, how would you do this, and how would you, disclose this message to everybody?
Yeah. So like do a back sell on like a Justin Timberlake song. And then come on and tell everybody what's going on and say, we'll be back with Miley Cyrus.
Right. It's Justin Timberlake, Mirrors on My 96, your at work station. It's Matt. And the website, the city website has just updated it, saying that the water has receded, and they are asking you, don't go home yet. We'll have more updates in a couple minutes coming up. Miley Cyrus with the 5 minutes.
Yeah!
That's
buddy.
That's
why
you're getting better,
for
man.
You.
Yeah.
Good for you.
God, I miss you sometimes.
That's nice hearing from you guys.
Yeah, no kidding. Hey, well, listen, stay safe.
Thank you.
And I think that's what you're supposed to say, but well, maybe if things get worse, we'll give you a call, but we appreciate your time. I know it's early there.
Oh, no problem. Not at all. Anytime.
And you're getting married, though, right?
Yeah, next February.
Surprised Dean, you don't have any words for that for him.
Do you know how I know he's stupid, so I don't have to even like it's a useless cause. He got to cheat legally in high school because he's that dumb. Didn't you?
I forgot I told you that.
Yeah, that's right. All right, man. Dude. Well, listen, congratulations on your improvement in radio. You sounded great.
Thank you very much.
Yeah, be safe, bud.
I will. Thanks, guys.
Hey, buddy, take care.
Bye.
Bye.
Oh, he's a nice kid. Still just want to hit him with something, though. Yeah, I don't know why.
He's just one of those guys.
Yeah, you just feel like slapping him.
Giving him a wedgie.
Like stabbing him with one of those compasses you use in high school. Ram.
This is the Dean Blundell Show. 102.1.
Yes.
This is your Edge.
Stop it. Hold it.
Files with Dean Blundell on the air.
California woman buried her husband in the backyard because she was too poor for a funeral. 59-year-old woman laid her 63-year-old husband to rest in a shallow grave behind their home. How shallow? His stomach and part of his nose still sticking out of the ground.
Oh.
Yeah.
Must have had a big nose. Stomach and big,
Police said the man had been ill for some time and there were no signs of foul play. The woman's neighbors are trying to raise money to give the man a proper burial. Now they set up a donation page where people can help with the costs. They are advising people, if you do not have enough funds for a funeral, to let the state know. Don't take matters into your own hands, as they say, quote, human burial is not fit for people's backyards.
I don't even like when people do that with their pets or whatever. I think that's odd too. I don't know.
Garbage, man. Go take them to the vet. Yeah, whatever. Yeah. That's where they put them.
Yeah. Just step on the nose a bit. Just get it down.
Yeah.
Just get it down. Make it flat.
Poor little old lady. Oh. Seattle man it's a crazy story. Arrested for crashing his car while carrying his daughters while he was high on meth. And wearing nothing but a pair of artificial breasts and a sheer blouse.
What?
Awkward. Jonathan Hardy reached speeds about 100 miles an hour, weaved through traffic near Seattle's airport, clipped a couple of cars before plowing into a guardrail. Police found him incoherent and naked from the waist down. When they cut away the top he was wearing, they found he had glued prosthetic boobs to his chest and apparently needed a bathroom since there was a bottle filled with whiz on the floor near his seat. When cops arrested him, he said he didn't really know what happened, told officers he was having a dream about being in a car crash. Neither he nor his daughters were injured, but he does face numerous charges, including hit and run, felony recklessness, child endangerment, and public nudity, as he wasn't wearing anything on the bottom. Man, how confused those girls would have been.
Oh, I know. Mom or dad or... what is that?
Yeah, and the fact he was on meth and crashed the car, too, that was a... But yeah, you're right. They'd probably be wondering why dad was wearing fake boobs.
Glued them on, too.
Yeah, super glued them on. Had to have them surgically removed. He really wanted boobs, didn't he?
That's an interesting breast augmentation surgery.
It's cheaper than the real one, I guess. And in New York, a stripper was driving around with 47 bags of heroin. Apparently, wow. For her, she wasn't wearing enough clothes to hide the product from the police when she was pulled over. Tiffany Evans was driving home after a shift from the strip club at 3 a.m., ran a red light. Which, if you've got close to 50 bags of heroin in your car... I mean, you really got to be careful of them red lights.
Why not just drive extra cautiously?
Yeah. The cops pull her over. According to Police Sergeant John Delaney, it was easy to see she was carrying contraband. During the traffic stop, officers could see that young Tiffany was attempting to stuff a large amount of heroin in her person. Quote, there was no pant leg. That's how short her shorts were. She tried to stuff them inside her and her pants. However, she couldn't get them in there. That's what it says right here. So clearly she hadn't been a stripper for that long.
Ah! Most we know can do 80 bags. Yeah.
Rookie. This is your Edge Files, whatever the hell day it is in June, the year 2013.
The Edge Files.
On 102.1.
The Edge.
The Dean Blundell Show. 102.1. The Edge.
Great day today, and as soon as the summer starts, everybody thinks two things. I think margaritas and patios, and the CFL is about to
start. Yeah,
right. Joining us, the commissioner of the CFL, Mr. Mark Cohon. Nice to see you, dude.
Good to be back.
Is it?
Yeah, it's great. I mean, God, the 100th Grey Cup went fast.
What a year for you, hey?
It was an amazing year, and now we're right back at it. And it was starting off, going to Winnipeg this week because we're opening the brand new stadium there.
Yeah, how is that stadium? I heard it's awesome.
It's pretty amazing. I was there 2 weeks ago for the preseason game. It's beautiful. 33,000 seats, $200 million stadium. The players were blown away.
I mean,
it's really a gorgeous place. And that's the modern CFL now. We've got other stadiums on the way, so it's pretty exciting.
Well, the old stadium was basically just like high school graduation bleachers set up on a field.
They not even have backs on the chairs in a lot of them?
Really? No, a little better than that. But I do remember my first press conference there as commissioner. We went out there and it was raining.
Yeah.
And behind me at the backdrop, the stadium was leaking.
Dripping.
Just move a little forward. We don't want you to get electrocuted. So it was time for a new stadium. And it's awesome.
Is it really?
Yeah, it's beautiful.
So Winnipeg got a new stadium this year. The CFL is as healthy as it's ever been. You guys set attendance records the last couple. Are you taking all the credit for this?
No.
You should?
No.
Why don't
not.
You? Why don't you just stand here and point at yourself going, it's all me?
That's not my family way. That's not the way I do it. Because my wife would kick my ass.
Yeah.
She knows the real me. We had an amazing run last year with the 100th Grey Cup. The city really rallied around it, but the country did. But, you know, when you think of it, the new stadium in Winnipeg, Hamilton's getting their new stadium next year.
Mm-hmm.
Ottawa's coming back, the Red Blacks.
Is that what they're going to be called, the Red Blacks?
Yeah, Ottawa Red Blacks.
You're kidding.
Was that their original name or?
No.
Rough Riders, right?
Rough Riders. It's sort of, Red Blacks. It rolls
why
off
can't
your
they
tongue.
Use Red Blacks? No, it doesn't. Why can't they use Rough Riders? Because that dude still owns a name and he won't give it up?
Well, we actually got the name back. But, we thought, time. For something new. They came back once as the Renegades. We talked about doing the Rough Riders. The Rough Riders in Saskatchewan said, listen, let's think of something new. And the Red Blacks is interesting. There's a lot of history around that city with the colors. So at first, I will tell you, at first when they came to me, I said, I don't like the name.
The Red Blacks.
Yeah.
Did you have veto power?
I did have veto power.
Yeah, that's so cool, man. Being the commissioner, you always have veto power.
You get to name
power.
A
team.
I did have veto power in that, and I said, go back to the drawing board. And then it grew on me, actually. We went, did research. A lot of the young kids in Ottawa like the name, so the younger kids, and they want to appeal to younger people. And now it's grown on me, so it takes a little bit of time. Listen, remember when the Blue Jays came out or the Raptors?
Yeah.
No one really loves the name. It's all about what you do in the community. It's the team you put on the field, and I think it's exciting that Ottawa's coming back, and that's a huge project. It's a $500 million redevelopment of where the stadium is.
Yeah, they're keeping part of Frank Clair Stadium too, right? They're trying to build a little bit.
You know, half of the stadium, and that's about $100 million for the stadium and office buildings and a condo looking right out over the field.
Could be honest God, the most boring city in the world too. So,
so they need
hopefully
that.
Inject some type of excitement into it. Yeah,
it's going to be great. And then Regina gets their new stadium in 2017. So we just keep on rolling. Now we're trying to figure out whether we can get to a 10th team.
Well, why don't you? Like, because if you could do a 10th team, like if they said, okay, you can do one, your window is right now. Where would you put it?
Well, I think we got to build a stadium first. But I just had an interesting meeting with the mayor of Halifax. Mm-hmm. And he wants to, you know, he's looking at what we did in Ottawa with that redevelopment project. You know, can he find a location and do that in Halifax as well and build, use the CFL and a stadium as a catalyst for more urban development? I think Halifax would be interesting. We're going back to Moncton this year for Touchdown Atlantic. And that's a little bit of a smaller town, but
fans would support that. Yeah, no? They're looking for stuff to do too.
Yeah, they are. The interesting thing about the Maritimes, which I think would be great, is try and do a community-owned model, exactly like we have in Saskatchewan or in Winnipeg, where the whole region gets around it. And that's something that we're starting to explore now.
Oh, good for you. It's exciting though. You know, it's for anybody that says, and I went to my very second, I think it was my second CFL game ever. This last year, we went to the, what was the East final?
Yeah, we went to the first
playoff
game.
The semifinal. It was the East semifinal.
Yeah.
And Montreal, or sorry, Toronto won. And it was honest, and my kids even say this to me, and you know, we make fun of the CFL, pales in comparison to the salaries, we make fun of somebody, but it was
well,
truly...
Well, that's Canadians,
typical.
Not just us.
You know, I understand, but it was truly an amazing experience, and I actually thoroughly enjoyed it, you know, because a lot of people go, the NFL's on, and I love watching NFL every single Sunday. Friday night football was never for me, and then I started to get into it, and then you follow the what do you call this team, the Argos? You follow them through their run.
What a
run they have for the league, too.
It was great. You know, this city is very important to the success of the CFL. The fact that the Argos had this phenomenal run created a lot of interest here. It was amazing. You know, 13 million people tuned in to watch the Grey Cup. I mean, phenomenal numbers. Mm-hmm. 3.5 million people in the Toronto area tuned in. So just a huge audience, a lot of excitement for them. You know, the first game is this Friday, and it's against our arch rivals, against the Tiger Cats. And, you know, I think those two teams are going to battle it out for the East this year, and it's going to be pretty exciting.
Mm-hmm. Well, you know what's neat about it, too, is not only just, you know, I guess a lot of us did jump on the bandwagon because they're doing well, but you realize how they're such supportive fans of the CFL and guys who probably should shower a little more. But, I mean, there are some great fans of the CFL.
Well,
how do you build on that? Yeah,
it's amazing. I mean, people stop and they say, okay, how many people watch a Raptors game? Well, last year, I think their average audience was 80,000. How many people watch an Argos game? Average audience, 700,000 people.
Yeah, right?
Wow.
So just the size and scope, I think in Toronto, sometimes we don't appreciate it enough how big the CFL is and how big the Argos are. Now, you know, I think the future for the Argos have to think about a brand new stadium, a more intimate setting. I think it's tough in the Rogers Centre, and they've talked about it with the Jays potentially going to a grass field. So that's something they have to think about. But I think there's great momentum coming out of the 100th Grey Cup, great momentum coming out of that win. And, you know, Toronto wants winners, and I think the Argos are going to be a strong team again. And I think hopefully more people will jump on the bandwagon.
Well, they were our only playoff team in the past 10 years, and they actually won the whole thing. So, I mean, give them
they've
some
won ups. It twice in the past 10 years.
Oh, yeah. Have they? Yeah. Really?
In 04 as well.
Well, so. Yeah, they won in 04 and didn't make the playoffs for 10 and then won it again.
Exactly.
God, I love the CFL. Mark Cohon, our guest, excited for the 2013 Grey Cup season. All the best. Where's the Grey Cup this year?
It's going to be in Regina, be a lot of fun.
It'll be very cold.
I know. I've been talking to the guys at Canada Goose trying to get a sponsorship out of
that. Oh, that's brilliant. Yeah, that's a brilliant idea.
You got like sponsorship just for you?
Exactly. Who cares? I got to stay warm. I got to present that cup.
The Chorus Broadcasting System presents
The Dean Blundell Show.
It's going to be a super-duper program for you.
102.1.
Time for your phone calls. 416-870-3343. I like these ones. Drew, what's up? Drew.
Hey, what's up, buddy?
What's up, dude?
Not much, man. Need you guys' help. My best friend's getting married. Bachelor party's in a couple of weeks. I'm not the best man, but I've been...
Why?
The bigger question is, you should ask who the hell he's marrying.
Who the hell is he marrying?
My ex-girlfriend.
How was she?
Well, it was 10 years ago, so I mean...
How was it?
For me, it was hell.
Does he know this?
Pardon?
Does he know it was hell for you?
Well, he was, for lack of a better term, he was there for it. I mean, he saw what I went through. And when I broke up with her, he needed to get laid. So I said, okay, fine. Ryan, Melissa, Melissa, Ryan. And 10 years later, he puts a ring on her. But anyways, I need some help with the bachelor party.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, I need. I'm coming up with a to-do list, and I need. I was wondering if you guys had any ideas of, you know, just weird, humiliating stuff that I can do for that he can do.
I've never been a fan of the humiliating stuff you can do, like painting guys' balls blue and having strippers pour stuff all like maple syrup and feathers. And
it's a lot.
We're not going to a strip club. We're actually going to be going up to Muskoka for 4 days for the bachelor party. The bachelor party is going to be 4 days long.
I got it. You want to embarrass him? Just show a ton of old photos of you and his future wife.
Yeah, put it on a slideshow.
Yeah, there you go.
All the pictures, all the nudies you took of you guys in various states of undress. Just show him all the pictures. Like, paste them everywhere. Like, make posters and put them all over where you're staying.
And, nice. And serve sloppy joes, because he has your sloppies.
Now, I have a question. Is it offside if my shirt, because we're getting t-shirts for the bachelor party, is it offside if my shirt says the groom is marrying my sloppy seconds?
Yeah.
Is that offside?
Yeah, because when she hears about it, man, will she be mad.
Yeah,
nobody's going to know about this. There's going to
be... Oh, then go for it, yeah.
There's going to be an oath of secrecy taken before anybody picks up their shirts.
All right. Yeah, I guess so. It's all fair. But if I were you, I would do something like, if you really want to get him, like, wait till he's asleep and cut him with something.
Okay, I wasn't really going to go that far.
No, you have to. If you really want him to remember it, he's got to have a scar.
Yeah, get him a tattoo when he's hammered.
Yeah. No, wait. Get a homemade tattoo kit and make a tattoo for him.
On his forehead.
Yeah. Says the word wiener or something on his forehead.
Well, that's been done before.
Yeah. No, you know what? Just take him golf and having fun and get him really drunk.
All right. I thought either you or Todd would have some wacky ideas. By the way, Todd, happy belated.
Oh, thank you very much, man.
Yeah. No wacky ideas.
Yeah, you know, I never understood why guys want to do that to one another. Go out, have a good time. If there's some drinking involved and you're out, you know, usually an embarrassing story will happen organically. Yeah.
But don't do anything stupid to him.
No.
And don't embarrass the girl. Unless she's, like, he said she's not that nice, then go for it. But, like, hurt him. You know, just, like, hit him with, like, put a whole bunch of... You know what's hilarious? What? It's so funny when you do this. You take a pillowcase. We used to do this all the time.
Oh, no.
And you just fill it with, like...
Oh, here we go.
Fill bars of soap and stuff. Wait till he's asleep. Then you smash him in the face with his heart...
Right in the face. Really?
Yeah.
Wow, that's funny, isn't
it? Man, does that ever wake up?
Isn't that interesting?
Yep. Okay. Hi, The Edge.
Saving probably a lifelong...
What else? You take some Raid, and you put it in his drink.
Oh, my God.
Is that one of the best ones?
Like, yeah,
no,
the best
those are the good
ever.
Ones, are they? What about that Russian roulette game?
Yeah, I heard about that.
Fill it with one bullet. But he has to pull it six times. Man, this is the best.
Hi, The Edge.
Hey, Dean.
Hey, Kev.
Hey, how's it going, man?
Good, brother. What's up?
Hey, man, I've been listening to your station since Beverly and Live World Jive were on there.
Beverly and Live World Jive.
Oh, yeah, CFNY. Long time since you guys first came in here.
Yeah.
Well, I just want to say, I caught the end of your radio. I just came on a little while ago listening to you guys, and I apologize for that. Got up a little bit late today, but I heard that you had somebody from the CFL on there.
Yeah.
And, I did a lot of volunteer work with them, the first JPD program here in Canada, CFL and NFL.
Yeah.
And I want to say that to all the young kids out there, because I coach football as well at Our Lady of Mount Carmel, where, of course, Billy Talent's from. And I just want to say to all the young listeners, just hang in there and support CF Canadian football. Yeah. And I have a young guy that's just been added to the roster for the Edmonton Eskimos. He was going to be an Argo, but what ended up happening is that he went back to Windsor. They sent him back to Windsor, and then Edmonton just picked him up. And his name's Shape here, and I just want to say congratulations to him on making the team.
Oh!
Or you know what you do for a bachelor party?
Tell me.
This is going to be a good one. Yeah. You get like, you go, okay, who wants a Tic Tac? He's like, me, we're going to do the Tic Tac challenge. And you coat one of the Tic Tacs in rat poison. Oh, man. You won't believe his face when you give him rat poison instead at a bachelor party. It gets so sick. Might even bleed, like internally. Man, that's a trick. That's a joke, all right. Ernie. Ernie.
Hello.
Hi.
Hello.
Hi, Ernie.
Oh.
Hello.
What's up?
Hello.
Yeah.
You can hear us.
You're the best. Jeremy, what's up?
Good morning, guys.
Hey.
I hope you don't give me a boring.
Well, time will tell. I feel bad doing it, but it was pretty bad.
It was.
And so I can't just do it to, like, people that tell stories. I can't, you know, everybody gets the same treatment where everybody's on level footing here.
Okay. You guys were talking about public places and viruses and bacteria, and I just wanted to add to the conversation and share my story with you.
No. Might get a boring.
Okay, yeah. You might.
Just warning you.
We'll give it a go.
Okay, I'll make it quick. I went to look at a basement renovation. These dirty people did not clean their kitty litter box. I got an airborne virus that nearly killed me from the kitty litter box.
You serious?
I destroyed my... I was going to the gym 3-4 times a week. I was a beast, and destroyed me. It almost killed me. So the end of the world could be in the kitty litter box.
You never know. Instantly regret taking that call.
Yeah, but it's a good lesson. Change the litter boxes. That's why I don't like
don't
cats.
Get a cat.
I know. I can't
cats
stand
cats. Cats are the filthiest things in the world.
They bury their own poop in that thing, and then they come and they prance all over your face
Touch
later.
Touch your face with their poop hands.
Yeah, their poop paws.
Yep.
And they run around on your furniture where you put your head and slid it on your pillow. That's where they bury their poop.
You know what you should do at a bachelor party?
What?
This is a great one. You'll love this.
This is planning.
You take a guy.
Yeah.
You know the spinning game where he takes a bat and he puts it on his head and he spins around and closes his eyes, spin. And then he's like, oh, you got to run to the other side. Like, it's like a race.
Mm-hmm.
You know where they do that? They put their head on the bat.
Yeah.
And they do a whole bunch of spinning
and
circles.
They're
all dizzy.
Disoriented, sure.
Then you take the bat and you hit him right in the face with it as hard as you can.
Oh, that's a tough game.
Oh, man. Oh. And then go, now run to the other side, bitch. You know what that is? That's a bitch slap of fun. That's what that is.
Yeah, for a bachelor party?
Yeah.
Okay.
That is fine.
Oh. I've never played these games at bachelor parties. I see. Probably safer than sleeping with hookers.
Yep.
Yeah, yeah.
Big time. Hey, the Edge. Jen?
Hi.
How are you?
I'm good, guys. How are you?
Good. Where are you calling from?
Oakville.
Oh, you're rich.
No, I'm not. Anyway, I have a story for you. I've been trying to call for so long.
Sure.
So a few years ago, my husband now, it was my boyfriend, we went to his cottage, and we were fooling around, and he wanted to take some naughty pictures. So I let him, and when we got home, I said, make sure you delete them off the card, the SD card. So time went by, and I totally forgot about it. We went on vacation, took some photos, and when we got back, I wanted to show my parents. So my dad has this TV, big screen TV, and it has like a port in the TV to put the SD card. So I put that in there, and we're going through the photos. I think that there's another picture of the vacation, and I hit next on the little remote, uh-oh, and there's a picture of me on my knees looking up.
Oh, with POV.
With my parents right beside me on the big screen TV.
What'd you did you tell them it was a taco or something, or did you say, like, no, hey, that's a burrito? That's
my,
not
dad
a wiener.
My dad didn't say anything. I just, like, went white and said, please don't look at the TV, and I'm hitting back on the remote, but there's, like, a 10-second delay that felt like an hour. And my mom just started laughing, saying, I don't even know what I'm looking at. And I was like, shut up, Mom. Like, don't even try and cover this up. I wanted to die.
Kind of looks like mine. Well, before I had you.
No, it was right here.
Oh, yeah, there.
Yeah, you're not listening.
Oh, I thought it was just okay.
No, no. Did she give you five and say, you're lucky after?
No, she said, oh, don't worry, these things happen. I said, no, these things should not ever happen.
They did.
But, and then my dad didn't talk to me for like a half an hour.
Oh, and a big half hour?
Well, must it have been torturous. Really awkward. It was really awkward. And finally, he just started laughing and he said, don't ever show me pictures again. Or make sure you screen your pictures. So yeah, I died. And that has been an awesome story. And even now, when we go to show him pictures of vacation.
No, 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 no.
Can you go to these first?
You know what some guy suggested?
Well, oh, for a bachelor party
trick?
Oh, no.
What?
What?
Not you.
You know what he suggested?
I don't.
It's so funny. It's a great trick. Mildred actually wants to tell a funny one. Hey, Mildred, what's your suggestion for a bachelor party?
What they should do is actually while he's sleeping, he should climb to the back of the car and then drive up and down the street, yelling his wife's name.
Hilarious!
Isn't that great?
That is a great one. You tie him by his feet or his hands.
Oh, I did that a couple times.
Okay, that's what I thought. That's so funny. You do like 50 down a busy gravel highway.
I never heard of that one at all. No.
That is a riot.
The Dean Blundell Show. 2.1. The Edge.
Big flood in Calgary. Jesse Lumsden lives there. Canadian champion, world champion,
Sling sounds like he kills.
Are you Bob Slayer? Bob Sledder? Jesse?
It doesn't matter, Dean. It doesn't matter.
Bob Slayer?
The guy who slides down in a onesie.
Oh, you're gay. No, but what is it? What do you say? Bob Sledding? You're a Bob Sledder? Bob Slayer?
Bob Slayer. Yeah,
so you can use both. Both is applicable.
Sure. I don't think the word actually exists. So right. You just make it up as you go.
Well, yeah. I'm just trying to say, like, what would you say if you were to hand someone a business card, what would it say on it? That's what I'm asking.
Olympian.
How are you, brother?
Pretty good, considering. Pretty good.
Yeah, so where are you? Give me the, if you were a reporter and your basement's flooded, which it is, you live in Calgary.
Yep.
Where do you live? Explain the situation as best you can.
Well, I live, you'll know the area. I live on Memorial Drive in Sunnyside. I live on the river that goes through downtown. I don't know how it happened, but a block that I'm on in about half a kilometer each direction, we're pretty lucky in this situation. The river didn't breach the sides and come up to our doorsteps where it did pretty much everywhere else in our surrounding area. Eau Claire, which...
Eau Claire Market's like right on the Bow River too.
No way. Princess Point is completely flooded. Stampede Grounds is completely flooded. Yeah. So it in terms of the damage down High River and Bragg Creek got the worst of it, and you're seeing pieces of houses float down the river, and you know, it's a pretty sad story.
Yeah, and folks, just in case you don't understand the geography, High River is just south of Calgary on the way to Lethbridge, and the river, the big raging river that goes through, is the Bow River.
Yeah, the Bow River and the Elbow River are both flooded, mainly because of the rain and the runoff that's coming off of the mountains and timing of dams, and I think it was just a whole bunch of stuff happening at once.
Jesse, you sent me a picture yesterday. Is that the picture of what you would see from your house?
No, that's the picture you'd see from about a block and a half down, where the street is, all you can see is the median The street is completely flooded. I've had people sending me pictures of their houses, not more than a 5-minute walk away, and they've had water up to the ceiling in their basement. Oh. And they're in a basement apartment. So, I mean, I was evacuated 4 days ago. We're just getting allowed back in. Me and my roommate went back yesterday, and our landlord was there and it was her and her mother. So we kind of got to work and ripped up all the carpet and took out all the drywall necessary so we can get back in there sooner than later.
So that's the deal. Like if for people like you, are you back there now?
No. We're still not back there because everything has been moved out of the basement. And yeah, we're still not at the house.
So how many people got evacuated from Calgary?
100,000.
And it's a city of 1 million?
I don't even really know, to be honest. It's around there, I would guess.
Yeah, it's like 900,000, close enough to 1 million to be 1 million. But So a tenth of the city was evacuated, all in the downtown core.
Oh, yeah.
That's unbelievable. Oh, yeah. And I was trying to explain to Todd earlier, too. So the way the river works, as it comes through the city, if you're facing north where the river comes south, it's the Saddle Dome and the Stampede Grounds are a long way away from the river. I mean, there's a ton of water there.
Oh yeah, and I mean it's funny when you don't really understand the magnitude of a situation until you're in it. And we sat there watching the NBA finals while cops were knocking on our door telling us to get out, and we were thinking, and we did leave eventually that evening, but this was whenever the NBA finals was.
Friday.
We left that evening and went somewhere else, and the next day we're seeing on the news that people are having to be rescued from their homes because they didn't leave the evacuation sites, and people are trying to drive out, and then you get the geniuses trying to go for a float down the river.
Oh, dude, did you see that? See those guys on the, there's a guy on an inner tube I saw, and another in the back of a canoe with like a 2x4 just laughing his ass off.
Oh, that's the way you send the herd out, so.
You should have put a floaty device on your bobsled there and gone down the river.
Well, I know, I've seen, Twitter's pretty, it's blowing up here, and you see some pretty good ones, and then you see some pretty distasteful ones, and I saw one guy offering swimming lessons down at Sunny Bay or whatever it's called.
Oh, no way. And this was just on Twitter this morning. I saw that someone at a Home Hardware or Home Depot, don't quote me on it, I think it was Home Depot, charging $42 for a case of water.
Oh, it's embarrassing. Those businesses are gonna be exposed. And
have you heard any other stories like that?
Yeah, there's websites up now that people are going into stores and posting pictures, $20 for a bag of ice, and making sure that they post if it's a liquor store or whatever. And guys, actually a couple guys were talking about it on the radio out here on 92.9.
Oh, Fraser,
and they're saying telling them, you guys are messing up right now, because once this is all said and done, you may have made $20, but how much business are you going to lose because of it?
Mm-hmm.
That's ridiculous that people exploit situations like that.
Well, they did it. It's happened with that superstorm that happened in New Jersey, too, right? You remember when they were charging like $40 a gallon for gas and stuff, and it was just, it's a mess. But that's the sad part that comes out of this. Obviously, the destruction, and because it's a lot. I mean, if you understand the scope of Calgary, it's not a small city. See what you've seen, and to see 100,000 people in a town that size, a tenth of the city, get evacuated, and then to add to that, watching them get gouged for stuff. Someone told me, too, there was a $15 loaf of bread at a convenience store.
No, it doesn't. Honestly, it doesn't surprise me. I've seen just about everything happen over the last few days, and a bunch of the athletes were able to get out and volunteer a bit, and a bunch of them came over yesterday to help out. So the guys that are in pretty good situations are all lending a hand, which is good to see. The mayor is, I don't think he's slept for a week, and
he's a good guy hard. Too, huh?
Yeah, he's awesome.
Yeah.
I mean,
yeah.
He's shown his true colors throughout this event, so I think he'll be.
You want to trade?
Trade mayors. Ours would have float at least, you know that. They're pretty buoyant. Yeah.
Give me a straw.
Jesse Lumsden, our guest in Calgary for the floods, which is where he's at. Now, what happens? When is it supposed to be gone? Because are you still underwater in a lot of parts? Like, it's not going down very quick?
It's starting to. So, slowly, and people are allowed back in certain areas. The downtown core is still evacuated, so only homeowners going for assessments and whatnot are allowed back in. The core businesses will still be shut down probably for the next few days. They're estimating that they won't have power till Wednesday. And
do you have where are you staying now?
I'm staying at my girlfriend's. Me and my roommate and his girlfriend are at my girlfriend's.
Oh, nice.
They're on a little further north and uphill, so they've been safe this whole time.
I think the most amazing part of this is you finally admitted to having a girlfriend.
Yeah. Or that at your age you still have a roommate, but okay.
Yeah, it's getting weird, Jess.
Listen, let's not get started on Todd, okay?
Okay, yeah, exactly.
Happy birthday, by the way.
Thank you, sir. I appreciate it.
That's great.
Yeah, 40. And he doesn't have a roommate.
Well, I still got 10 years to go then.
Yeah, you're good.
That's
then.
True. Okay.
Jesse Lumsden, our guest. Hey, listen, dude, all the best to you. I really appreciate your time. I know it's early in Calgary, but glad you're safe, and I hope everybody you know is safe. And I don't know, do you plan on helping out? Like, do you plan on going to hand stuff out? Or?
Yeah, well, I was volunteering at Winsport when they were taking people in, and then once we start figuring out, like, some of the cleanup needs to be done, I'm sure I'll be getting involved with some of that a bit. And everybody's on Twitter. It's been keeping everybody in the loop, and which has been good. But yeah, I'll keep busy somehow.
Where are you on Twitter so people can follow you? Because I know you've been posting stuff about it.
Jesse Lumsden 28.
Jesse Lumsden 28 Twitter. Thanks for your time, dude.
Just a real man.
Yeah, no problem.
All right, buddy. Take care.
Talk to you guys later.
You bet. Bye. Yeah, $42 for a case of water.
Nuts. He's a good dude.
Great guy.
I wouldn't volunteer.
No.
I'd like, who can I sell electronics to now?
Who can I sell water to for $41?
The Dean Blundell Show, 102.1 The Edge.